Good evening and welcome to The Journey Home. My name is Marcus Grodi, your host for this program. And this is the third week of the month in which we developed the tradition last year of featuring converts, international converts. And of course, we began the first seven, eight months of this featuring the episodes that we taped in England. And now we're following up with episodes from Canada. But didn't have the privilege this time of going to Canada to film the episodes. I hope to do that in the future. But we did decide to fly some of the converts down. And Father Eric Nicolai is with us tonight. And he is a priest of the Opus Dei Prelature in Montreal. And he'll be with you in a moment to give his story and to answer your questions later. But I want to begin the program, though, to remind you that this week, of course, is March for Life in Washington, D.C. And our coverage of the march will begin on Wednesday evening, January 21st, the Mass for Life at 8 p.m. Eastern Time. You'll be sure to turn into that. And you know also that after the Mass, we'll have a number of interviews. So please pray for our coverage of that Mass for Wednesday night. Then also on Thursday, starting at 11 a.m. Eastern, we'll have our coverage of the March for Life in Washington. So please join us for that. And pray for all who will attend that the impact of that march will continue to impact America, to awaken us to our pro-life calling as we seek to serve Jesus. Now, for your questions for our program, if you have one for Father Nicolai, give us a call at 1-800-221-9460. Or you can, if you're outside North America, you can give us a call at 205-271-2980, or you can send us an email at journeyhome@ewtn.com. Father Nicolai, welcome to The Journey Home.
Pleasure to be here.
It's great to have you here. I think we had you scheduled early, but there was some mix-up in scheduling, but it's great to finally have you here. And you're a priest with the Opus Dei Prelature.
Yeah.
And well, may have a chance to talk about that later, but it's great to have you here. And I'm also excited because you're English French, right? I mean, you've got the from Montreal, which is what percent?
Well, we have in Montreal about 80 to 85% is French speaking, and the rest is both English and other languages. But so, you know, we usually work in both languages, but mainly French.
You'd like to extend a greeting to our French viewer?
Bon, je vous souhaite tous une belle soirée ici à EWTN, ici à Alabama, si vous êtes en train de regarder ça.
Did you tell them it was cold down here too? Or?
No, I said if they were actually watching, you know, I hope they are.
Oh yeah, well that's great. It's great to see our coverage in Canada increase.
Yeah.
So we
do
pray for that. But every week I invite the guest to give us a spiritual background to your journey. So if you would you give us your early spiritual journey?
Well, my background, I would have to go back in the roots of my background. My father is originally from Germany, but it's no longer Germany today. It's part of Poland. Mm-hmm. He came from a city in what was then Germany called Breslau. And well, his father had actually converted to Catholicism, but he doesn't remember anything. So what happened was that at the end of the war, the Russians were coming, and he had to escape from Breslau, and he ended up in Dresden, and he lost his father. His father died, and they found the horses in a ditch somewhere, and so he lost his father, but he knew that his father had been Catholic. But that's all he knew, and he had presumably been baptized. And so he had two brothers and a sister, rather. And when his father had died, his mother saddled all the children over to the Lutheran church, because she was a Freemason. So they don't like the Catholic Church too much. So he grew up with a certain antagonism against the Catholic Church. Right? And that was sort of, well, it wasn't very clear at home, but I basically grew up with no religion, basically, even though I had eventually been baptized, in fact. No? So my father, with my mother, they met in Hamburg later on in the 50s, and my mother also had not been brought up with any religion either. So we've got two immigrants here arriving in Canada, in Montreal, in 1962, and Well, the only contact really with religion is that they went to a Lutheran church in order to be able to make some friends. You know, they wanted to make some friends, get to know some people. But I mean, I certainly don't remember any of that. Oh. I grew up without any specific training in, you know, religion and anything. I didn't know really very little that I knew, I must say. Now,
so prayer wasn't even an active part of your family?
No, we never had that. No, we never went to church. I had friends that would go to church, but in that time, this was in the early 60s, I was born in 63, I was living in Quebec, so the province of Quebec, 95% of the people there are Catholic, all French speaking, but it was a time of great change, you know, and basically a lot of people unfortunately abandoned the faith, and many of my friends that I'd grown up with were not practicing. But when my parents wanted to register me to school as a little boy, they said, okay, the French language is the up-and-coming language. We've got to register him into a Catholic French school. Okay, they wanted me to be brought up Catholic, but mainly because of the French. So they brought me there, and in the Catholic schools, they said, oh, you're Protestant, sorry, we can't take you, sorry, you'll have to go, you're Protestant, so we can't take you. So I ended up in an English-speaking Protestant school, right? So nevertheless, it was Protestant, but it was really only by name, you know? So that's how I grew up, without any formal training, until I arrived in what we call, in Quebec, we call it Cégep, here, you know, we have high school, I guess it finishes at grade 11 or 12.
Usually 12.
Yeah, here in Quebec, we finish in grade 11. And then we do 2 years of what's called Cégep. It's like a pre-university college, where some of them are technical, some of them are there to prepare you for university. And you usually change schools, and you meet a new group of people. So I was, at that point, I was 17 years old. And as I say, I didn't have, I just didn't, questions didn't hit me. But then I went to Cégep, and I started studying fine arts. And I became super enthused with the idea. We would do painting, we'd do sculpture, and I think it was in large part due to the influence of my mother, who was a, you know, fairly, you know, accomplished ceramics artist. And this was getting fascinating. I loved this. We would go to galleries. We would go to New York. It was, I mean, life was great. Yeah. But the people I was studying with, some of them were Baptists. And they were very, like, I'd never met very staunch Baptists like that. And what happened was, every time I would say, oh, God, they would jump on me. You know, they said, you can't say that. Or if I would say, I would say, Jesus is the word Jesus, you know, the name Jesus. And they would like say, that's taking the Lord's name in vain. You can't do that. And I said, come on, man, let's not exaggerate, you know. But they would jump on me. They would not miss a single time that I would either say God or Jesus in just normal parlance, you know. They would say it was taking the Lord's name in vain. And they would get kind of incensed by this, you know. And, well, you know, I'm 17 years old. I'm starting to develop some, little, but some intellectual capacities. Not very many, but I started to realize, geez, I'm using the word Jesus and God quite a bit without even knowing who this person is. Mm-hmm. You know? And it struck me also as rather mystifying that God should actually have a name. You know? Mm-hmm. I thought that was, you know, Jesus, that he was a person, you know. And so these Baptists opened me to the possibility that Jesus was a person, you know. But again, I must say, I kept my distance, you know. I didn't enter into it. It was something that I started thinking about. And then when I would speak to my father about this, he would say, well, this is a phase. This is a phase you're just going through. Relax. It's going to pass. So I believed him. I thought, yeah, it's probably a phase that I'm going through. I'm eventually going to get over this, you know. But I just couldn't get these thoughts out of my mind. And now, as I told you, I wasn't a big intellectual. I was more a kind of a visual guy. And they one of the fellows there, who was a very good drawer, he was a very good draftsman, and he influenced me in the way he drew. He was very good at the way he did that. He gave me a Good News Bible. Mm-hmm. Good News. And what did I like about that Bible? The drawings. The drawings, okay? Yeah, and if you look at those drawings, they're wonderful, because they're a bit influenced by Matisse, who was Henri Matisse, who was a French painter in the 20s and so forth. And I just love these drawings. You know, they were, you know, they
very
I still
simple, right?
Very simple, just line drawings, you see. Yep. And I would go through this whole Bible, and then I would see like a drawing, for example, in the New Testament part, for example, of the marriage at Cana, you know, a picture of these people pouring water, just, you know, one line for the water. It was so beautifully suggestive, you know. And I said, well, if I start reading this, I'm going to get, it's going to be more than just a phase, you know. And I still remember, for example, seeing the drawing for the woman with the that was crouched over, you know, that touched our Lord's cloak, because I didn't know this story. I didn't know what this was, you know. But I saw the drawing, and I said, maybe this, what is this lady doing? She's kind of curved over like that, and there was just like a nice line for our Lord's, there was like a thing for his foot, and it was a beautiful drawing. And I would imitate some of these things in my own drawings, you know, like some of the style I kind of liked. So when I started seeing those drawings, that I started lightly going in there and reading the stories. But again, I have to say I kept my distance. I don't really know why, but a whole world was opening itself to me there, you know. And again, I didn't read a lot. I was not a big reader. I didn't read big books about this. And I was more struck by sort of the visual impact, as I think I still am today, you know, in many ways. You know.
Now, you were at that time planning on art as your career?
Yeah, I had this dream. I was going to be, you know, the next, who was my, well, I, you know, I had Henri Matisse, I had David Hockney, who was, I think he's an English painter. He's more of a contemporary, you know. And I used to try to imitate the way he drew and stuff. This was definitely my goal. And I had a girlfriend that she was actually in Germany. And I had this plan.
There was your plan.
This was my plan. I was going to be an artist one day. And I was a bit of a bohemian, I have to say. You know, I used to like to wear different colors, and very, very different from the colors I'm wearing now. You know?
Wore all the colors out. Now you're down to black.
That's yeah.
But. It is interesting, just to pause a second, that how God can use all different kinds of things for all different kinds of people. Mm-hmm. I mean, those drawings, when I think about, they are wonderful drawings in that Bible. Mm-hmm. But I was always more drawn to the text and not so much the pictures, because of the work that I was using the Bible for. Mm-hmm. But yet that artist knew when he drew those. And of course, God used that specifically for you in that sense. And to me, that's it bespeaks to the voice of God that he can use through the arts and through the music and through culture. It isn't only in the Bible or only in the written text that God, you know, he's trying to touch people's hearts as well as the mind, which he did for you. All right, well then what was it that hit you with a 2x4 and got your attention toward the Catholic Church?
Well, you know, the whole time I was thinking, okay, well, this is all nice stuff, but it's all basically invented. Let's face it, all this stuff has got to be invented. My idea was, I read some of the stories, and they're all very nice, beautiful, they're fantastic, but you're not going to tell me this is true. You know? And
was that the kind of the reigning attitude in Canada at the time?
Well, I don't know if it was in Canada, but certainly it was in my in my environment, certainly with my father. They're nice stories, and they're beautiful literature. In fact, you should read them, but don't start thinking that this is true, like this, the word true, you know. And I was quite impressed, for example, going one time with my Baptist friends, who I'd become very good friends with, you know. I mean, they were good friends. We had long conversations. He took me once to a mall, and in the mall there was a big auditorium there, and there was a Baptist meeting of some kind, and the preacher started, the whole place was just jammed with people, and he held up his Bible, and he looked around like this, and then somebody raised their hand and said, you know, John 3:10, or, you know, it was just any phrase. And he said, that's one of my favorite passages. Thank you very much. And I was like, what's this guy doing? And of course, the guy had a perfect knowledge of the scriptures, and then he would preach about this. And then somebody else would say, 2 Corinthians 15, if that exists. But and he would say, thank you, I like that, you know, and with just all these numbers, you know. So I realized I had to start reading more. But as I read more, I remember one time on the bus realizing that, why would it all be invented? Like, why would somebody go through all the trouble of just inventing all this, you know, because if it's not true, it would have to be invented. So that hit me. But then, you know, what I couldn't connect with was that these people I was with, they were good friends, but something about it, about being with them, just impeded me from sort of taking the leap. And that's when I met my friend Dwight. Dwight was a little bit older than me, but we had already known each other as kids. We used to play hockey in the street and stuff, ice hockey and things. And he was Catholic. He was well-built, strong guy, had big arms. But he was suffering a lot. He had a lot of trouble at home. He was, he was not actually living with his own parents. Well, although we all thought these were his parents, but they were not actually his parents. He had lost his father when he was very young. We didn't know this. And then he was living with his other family. And I saw in Dwight, whom I knew before, but now I saw somebody who needed consolation, needed help, right? So we talked, and I knew he was Catholic, and of course the Baptist had told me all kinds of horrendous things about the Catholic Church, so I was certainly keeping my distance from that. But we became very good friends. We would listen to music together, and of course, as a friend, I would accompany him in many places, and of course, he would go to Mass every day, and I would accompany him to Mass, not because I wanted to go to Mass, but because he was my friend, and we would talk on the way, and not about religious topics necessarily, but if you like, the friendship was going deeper and deeper, and he would talk to me about his problems, and I felt like an obligation really to, you know, to help him. And I remember one time we're walking to the church, and it's quite cold, and we're talking, you know, about, I don't remember what it was, but we were talking, and, you know, excitedly, and he says, okay, Eric, stop talking. Look, we have about 20 minutes left before we arrive to the church. I have to say my rosary today. I have to say it every day. And if I don't start saying it now, I'm not going to have time to say it. So look, you got to help me, because otherwise I'm going to get distracted. And I said, what do you mean? What is this rosary thing? What are you talking about? I didn't know what it was. So he said, look, don't worry about it. I'm going to say, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed. And you say, Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour. That's all you have to say. Don't pray. Don't pray. Just say it, okay? I'm not forcing you to pray. Just say it. So, are you sure? Okay, well, you're my friend. You need me to help you. I'm helping you. So I just sort of memorized it on the spot there. Holy Mary, Mother, what is it? Holy Mary. Okay? So bit by bit, I began to memorize the Hail Mary without praying. I wasn't praying. I'm not praying. I'm just being your friend, okay? So don't think that I'm getting involved in this, you know? And so he would take me to the Mass, and I would sit there with him, and I would pretend to be observing everything, and, you know, I'd watch the signs of the cross. And then after the Mass, we would always go to do a visit to the Blessed Sacrament. He always did a visit to the Blessed Sacrament. So the Blessed Sacrament was off on the side chapel, and he would just go and just, you know, throw himself down and, like, asking for help. You know, he had trouble at home. He was trying to get better marks. You know, he was just... And I would just sit there, you know, like as an observer, and I could just feel his pleading there in front of our Lord. You know? And this had quite an impact on me. You know? So bit by bit, he would tell me some things about the faith. But again, they were sort of more historical. I didn't allow this to influence me too much. And then one day, as I say, you know, I wasn't a big reader, but things hit me, you know. And I remember one day, this would have been Christmas 81. So we're in the eastern townships of Montreal. This is about 150 miles outside of Montreal, in a cottage area. And both my parents and his parents had a cottage in that area. He was about 30 miles away. And the church was about 20 miles from where we were. And so he would come down, he would hitchhike, come down, pick me up, and then we would have to hitchhike together in the dead of winter to go to Mass, right, in this other town. And so I remember leaving maybe around for an 11 o'clock Mass, leaving around 9:30 in the morning. And I was, again, I was just accompanying, just accompanying you, because you're right. And we would talk on the way. And we would hitchhike, we would wait for, and this is through country roads, the dead of winter, it's freezing cold. And I remember one time, Mass is at 11, okay? By now it's 10:30 or so, or 10:45, and it's freezing cold. My feet are freezing, my hands are cold. And I said, Dwight, no car has stopped, okay? God is gonna understand, okay, that you didn't make it to Mass, okay? He's gonna understand. He's not gonna, you know, I was getting like frustrated with him, you know, like, come on. And he looks at me with a look of, desperation, and he says, didn't you pray to the guardian angel? The what? Yeah, didn't you pray to the guardian angel to ask for a car to stop? And to me, guardian angels were just the quintessence of medieval invention, you know? I said, guardian angel, are you nuts? Come on, that's just an invention. You're not going to tell me I have to pray to a guardian angel. He said, look, you pray to the guardian angel, I will pray to the guardian angel, and if in 4 minutes nothing happens, good, we'll turn around, we'll go back, we'll have hot chocolate, we'll warm up, okay? And I said, oh, guardian angel, guardian angel. So, okay. And no sooner had I said that, this car pulled up, you know. And he looks at me, he says, after you, you know. Get in the car, why don't you? I was dumbstruck by this, you know. It was really, if you like, you know, a moment of almost fear, I would say, you know, because I really sensed that the divine was at work. And then I remember even more, we got into the car, we were cold, and we were, you know, trying to warm up. And the guy driving is in a Jeep, and he's dressed for to go skiing. And he's got an 8-year-old boy, 10-year-old boy next to him. And he says to us, so where are you guys going? Well, we're going to Magog. Just drop us off there, says Dwight. He goes, oh, well, is there anywhere in particular you would like me to drop you off? I can drop you off somewhere. No, it's okay. I'm looking at Dwight. He doesn't want to tell him, because he was very discreet, you know, about his faith. And so finally the guy says, no, tell me, where are you going? I will drop you off there. And so Dwight says, well, we're just going to Mass. You know, we're just going to Sunday Mass. I goes, oh, you're going to Mass. You're going to church. You mean that church, St. Patrick's Church, there at the corner of Mary Street? Yeah. So there was a silence. And then the fellow looked over at his son. Silence. And Dwight looks at me and he says, pray to the guardian angel, pray to the guardian angel. Pray to the guardian angel. And the fellow says, I haven't even baptized you. And I haven't been to a church in, he gave some huge figure, I don't know what it was, 30 years or whatever it was. And he says, that's it. I'm going to church with you. I'm going to Mass with you. I haven't been. And maybe, you know, maybe I should even go to confession. And I was quite struck by this, you know. And Dwight says, keep praying to the guardian angel. Keep praying. Like, so by that time, the guardian angel had just totally won over me, you know. I mean, now I was in a moment of total awe, you know, at this, what was happening here. And then we went in and we didn't see the guy. The guy went into the Mass, you know, he parked the car, whenever, we didn't see him. Well, he went in and he went to Mass. And I'll never forget entering that church with Dwight, and the Mass had begun, just barely, and it was packed. And as he entered, he was looking for an empty spot, and all of a sudden, as he was walking right in front of me, he genuflected. Boom, he was down, on his knees. And he genuflected, you know, bowing his head. And for some reason, I hadn't picked this up before, this idea of a genuflection. Mm-hmm. I don't know why, but maybe he must have done it before, but the way he did it and the sense of awe that was filling me at that moment, and like I could see him kneel there as he was leaning on the pew, he was sort of saying, thank you, God, for bringing us here, you know? Mm-hmm. And for the first time in my life, I said, thank you, God, you brought me here, man. you know, and I prayed.
So was it, I mean, there's where your heart was opened, right? I mean, at that point, all the preparation that came into it, and you really pointed out there that on the one hand, the Lord, it's interesting the way the Lord works, right? Your interest in art was the tool, but also the friendship was that tool that opened your heart to the church.
Yeah.
And eventually bringing you into the church and priesthood, and then even Opus Dei. We're going to need to take a break, and we'll come back in a bit. But we'll take questions as they come, but I also have a couple questions about, one of which is, it seems to me knowing Opus Dei, the emphasis of Opus Dei, seems to me, I wonder if you're drawn to that because of the witness of Dwight. It's an interesting model there because it is seeking holiness, which is what he modeled for you.
Yeah.
But let's take a break. We'll be back in just a moment. Welcome back to The Journey Home. My guest tonight is Father Eric Nicolai. He's a priest of the Opus Dei Prelature, and you've done a fine job of summarizing that journey. Obviously, we can't get everything in, but maybe the guests, the callers might have a question about more details of your journey. But I would like to cap it off and talk about your call to, I mean, you're called a priesthood, but particularly Opus Dei. What drew you to that particular prelature of the Catholic Church?
Well, Dwight was not in Opus Dei. But he had been discerning the priesthood for a while. He had been thinking about it, at least. He didn't become a priest. And he was going to see a priest of Opus Dei about that. And that priest was helping him a lot. And he had a great affection for that priest. And he's a priest today, still in Montreal. Mm-hmm. And he didn't actually invite me to this center of Opus Dei for the longest time. He wanted me to be ready for it, I suppose. And he wanted me to be ready. And then one day he said, okay, meet me at this subway station, Guy Concordia subway station, that's the exact one. And he said, you know, well, this was, of course, after I'd become Catholic, right? What happened was, I should say that he put me in contact with a diocesan priest who's involved with the Priestly Society of the Holy Cross, which is intrinsically united to Opus Dei. And he gave me the first formation, right? And I was eventually received into the Catholic Church, you know, about a year later, right? And that's when my parents came to the church and the first time, and the next time was when I got ordained, right? But this priest was a very good man, and Dwight came and accompanied me also this time, right? And I came to know more about the faith, and I was eventually received. But getting to know Opus Dei, well, was quite simple. He said, well, meet me at this subway station. And you know, I was waiting for him there, and he arrives, and he says, okay, now close your eyes. I have something for you. And I said, well, what? Close your eyes. So I closed my eyes, and he puts a rosary over me like this, you know. And I had learned about the rosary, but the actual rosary beads I was not familiar with, right? I just used to count like this. I just didn't have a rosary. So I thought this was a nice necklace, you know? It was kind of a nice necklace, you know? So we both went up like to the center with these rosaries hanging around. And we arrived there, and he introduced me to Father Jerry, the priest of the center. And there was a recollection going on, so there were meditations being preached by the priest. But immediately he took me up to his room, and we talked a little bit. And he said, look, we don't have much time to talk right now, but right now we have a benediction to the Blessed Sacrament. Now, this is something I hadn't been exposed to. I knew about the Eucharist, I knew about Mass, of course, but a benediction I didn't know. And he said, and I know you're new to the church, so remember, we can also worship our Lord in a benediction, and we use incense as the prayer of the saints, right? Going towards our Lord. Oh, we have to go. The benediction is right now. So we went down, this nice little chapel, and there was something I'd never imagined. There was this beautiful singing. Oh, there was, you know, maybe 15, 20 guys there. And he had this monstrance with, you know, gold and and emeralds, and then he, you know, did the benediction with this and with the smell of the incense and so forth. And I didn't realize that you could not only receive our Lord, but you could actually worship him by singing to him like that. And it just encapsulated how much our Lord is really a person that you can see there, right? And this struck me. And so I started going to means of formation there, meditations. And at one point, a year or so later, my parents moved to Toronto, so I moved with them, and I came in contact with the center there. And they were just starting. They were just at the beginnings. This was in 82. Anyway, I started going to means of formation there. But I had always thought, God wants me to be married, and I'd already had somebody in mind. But then, somebody had proposed to me, well, what do you think? You know, do you think maybe God is calling you to Opus Dei? Do you think? What do you think? Pray about it. And I said, yeah, but marriage. Well, be careful, because he might ask you more. And I'll never forget the way he said more. The word more just it just resonated. Not that marriage is somehow less, right, obviously, you know, but the word more, like I had always planned marriage, this is it. But he might ask more. And I just could not get that word out of my head, you know. I just could not get it out. And I remember going that was around Christmas time, and going to my parents' cottage, and I just could not stop thinking. And then I came back, and I wrote a letter to the prelate at the time, asking for admission, you know, to live apostolic celibacy in Opus Dei. You know. That was the beginning, you know. It was very exciting.
And you didn't begin by thinking about priesthood. It was always serving as a
yeah. My intention, of course, was to be what's called a numerary, a lay celibate member. And by that time, I had changed from studying visual arts to going into art history. I had decided the art world was a bit too bohemian for me at that time, and I decided to go more into the sort of academic side of it, and I really liked that. But I really wanted to stay in that, and that was very clear to me that that's what I would be doing, though I knew that I could at one day be asked to be a priest if I discerned that that's what God wanted, you know? Yeah. And in fact, a few years later, I was asked if I would like to go to Rome.
All right, let's take our first caller. This is Mary from Illinois. Hello, Mary. What's your question for us tonight?
My question is, I would actually like you to comment on Opus Dei relative to some of the fallacies that are put forth in the book, The Da Vinci Code. It's created a lot of confusion, particularly with respect to bodily, you know, mutilation. And if you could just comment on that, that would be...
Don't say too much about that stuff. It'd be intriguing. Someone might want to actually go out and buy the book. We don't want to encourage that. Yeah. But what do you think, Father?
Well, mutilation is a big word, eh? I mean, anybody who mutilates himself is not going down the right road, you know. Yeah. Now, I mean, the Da Vinci Code. It's a book of fiction. You know? I think we have to underline the fact that it's fiction, right? Even though it says fact at the back that Opus Dei isn't, you know. An institution of the Catholic Church. It's a, strictly speaking, a personal prelature. And there is talk about what we call corporal mortification, right, which is a practice that is traditional in the Church, and that is should be very restricted, and has nothing to do with those images of self-mutilation that precisely that book tries to underline and give an impression of mystery about. You know, it's nothing like what that book presents. Now, it is true that some numeraries, only the lay celibate members, because our founder, you know, encouraged us to do it, to live that kind of mortification, you know, do occasionally do that. You know? But there's no blood or anything like that.
Well,
it's
what you would mean would be like, wasn't it true that the first bishop of the United States, John Neumann?
Yeah.
No, he's not the first bishop. John Carroll was the first bishop, but John Neumann, St. John Neumann, yeah. would always wear a hair shirt. Yeah. I mean, that was the tradition. It's that kind of of us going through different levels of suffering.
Yeah. Well, that's the purpose, is you want to identify yourself with our Lord. I mean, that's the only purpose, and it's a way of identifying ourselves with his passion, and really to obtain anything of value, whether it's vocations, whether it's growing interior life, you know, one has to deny oneself. But I mean, there are many ways you can do that. You can do it at meals. I mean, the most important ones, the most important, our founder said, the best mortification really is a smile when you don't feel like it. When you got somebody who's annoying, you know, smile. You know, that's really the most important one. And the fact that people react so heavily against this, what's called corporal mortification, says more about them, right, than about those who actually do it. It says more about the fear we have of just suffering, you know, like how dare we inflict any pain. But it's not pain, it's just more discomfort.
Really. It also, we have this widespreading movement of the health and wealth gospel in America. Mm-hmm. And there's the other extreme, that there is no sickness, there is no suffering. And it's the other extreme, and so of course they would therefore write off any aspect of suffering as being extreme. Before we take another email, though, she also asked you to describe Opus Dei. Maybe give a quick definition of what Opus Dei is. So those reading the book probably don't get a good picture of what. And I haven't read the book. And I don't think you had either.
No,
right?
I'm too interested in reading. Well, Opus Dei, technically speaking, it's a personal prelature of the Catholic Church. So. It's a part of the Catholic Church. It's not a religious order, right? And that means that the structure, personal prelature, corresponds to the charism that it received, that our founder received from God. And the charism is, if you like, the mission within the church to spread the divine message of the sanctification, or better said, the universal call to sanctity. That is, all people are called to sanctity, and they are called especially in the midst of ordinary activities. I underline ordinary. Ordinary activities and especially work. So, if you like, Opus Dei has received from the church the mission to transmit this message, right, and to give people the means to be holy in the middle of the world. And the main way we do that is basically formation. Right? That's the Opus Dei is a big catechesis, you know, and that is of different ages, of course, right? There's human formation, there's spiritual formation, you know, everything to be able to help a person be leaven, right, in the middle of society. Leaven is, you put it in bread, and the bread rises, but when you eat the bread, you don't say, what good leaven, you say, what good bread, well, that's good bread, but the leaven disappears. And that's what members of Opus Dei want to be.
That's why I've always liked Opus Dei, and especially the theology of Jose Escriva, Saint Jose Escriva.
Jose Maria Escriva.
Because too often, and not just in Catholicism, but in Protestantism, particularly Protestantism in the background I came from, that if you really want to serve Jesus, you've got to leave the secular world, the secular work, and go into religious life. So as a Protestant, to do that, you become a minister, you become a missionary. But if you're going to remain an engineer or a teacher, you're somehow settling for a lesser than. Mm-hmm. And the idea that St. Escriva was called to strengthen was that no, where you are
exactly.
is your calling. Mm-hmm. And those unique gifts you have for your work or for your proclamation or your mission field, mm-hmm. that's where you're called to grow in holiness. And really, he's really bringing back into a very practical mode what St. Francis de Sales was trying to teach back in Geneva back in the 1500s. Mm-hmm. You know, it's this idea of a sanctity for the layperson.
Yeah.
And it's wonderful stuff. And the only reason that I think, tell me if I'm right, Father, that people always want to put this suspicion on them. Mm-hmm. is because a person who's an Opus Dei, it isn't our calling to go around and tell everybody or to have a badge on our shirt. Mm. It's to follow the words of Jesus that if you're fasting, you clean yourself up and you don't look like you're fasting.
Yeah, it's, you know, we are there in the middle of the world. Mainly people are in their families and, you know, they're trying to be leaven, but, you know, they don't openly go and say they're members, but of course everybody who knows them knows that they're members.
Right. I mean, it's not that aspect.
It's not a hidden
society
thing.
Right. Right. Let's take an email, if we would. This comes from Delaney Arnold in Louisiana. We haven't got a Canadian person yet, but this lady may have come from French immigrants, right, from Canada at one point down to Louisiana. Dear Marcus, I am a cradle Catholic and am rediscovering the richness and truth of the Catholic faith. Your program has been an immense help in my journey. In the light of the publication of popularity, we got a Da Vinci Code email here, many questions have surfaced about Mary Magdalene's importance to Jesus. I have even seen a documentary mentioning the discovery of, quote, the Gospel of Mary, end of quote. As Catholics, how should we respond to these kinds of claims, and what is the Catholic Church's position on Mary Magdalene?
Mm-hmm. Well, that's a good question. Well, to be honest, I have never really studied the question of Mary Magdalene, but I know she's a saint, and I think she's sometimes confused with, the story of the woman with the alabaster jar that breaks the alabaster jar at the feet of Jesus, the one she said that she had seven demons taken out of her. So there's, it's not a clear-cut knowledge exactly of who she is, but I think, in order to respond to them, how do we respond to them? Well, I think we have to form ourselves well. I mean, there are, Opus Dei now actually has a website with a section on the Da Vinci Code, and you can see a whole bunch of links. Envoy magazine has a very, very good description of all the falsity, of a lot of the claims with regards to the Gnostic Gospels and the questions with regards to Mary Magdalene. It's a wide question.
Mary Magdalene's an interesting model of this being holy right where you are and who mm-hmm. you are. I mean, here's mm-hmm. this woman who we don't know very much about her, right? Mm-hmm. But it was really through her confession to Jesus that she's made new. Mm-hmm. There's no story of her ever becoming a nun or other than who she mm-hmm. was. Mm-hmm. And yet the Church recognizes her sanctity mm-hmm. and lifts her up as a model for mm-hmm. women to follow. Mm-hmm. So, and as to all these other books, you need to recognize, right, that early on, there were all these other writings, and the Church had to decide which were going to be in the Bible and which weren't. And so that was the authority given to the Church to do
that. But in that very book, he quotes some Gnostic Gospels that seem to suggest what he calls the feminine mystique, but he conveniently leaves out some very anti-feminine elements in those Gnostic Gospels that make you understand why the Church actually put those aside, You know, there's a horrendous passage at the end of, I think it's the Gospel of Mary, that says that I will take Mary to myself and make her into a man. But of course, Dan Brown doesn't mention that, I'll make her into a man.
Picks and chooses, which is too sadly the norm in those kinds of things. Let's take our next caller, Ed from Pennsylvania. Hello, Ed, what's your question?
I was going to ask Father, when he put up the fact that in Montreal, when he was growing up, it seemed like the people were abandoning the practice of Catholicism. And I remember I was in Passionist Formation in the 50s, and I went to school with the fellows came down from Canada, from Montreal. And it was, you got the impression that it was a pretty fervently Catholic area of Canada. And I heard that what you said is true up until the present time. In such a short period of time, what do you think the reason for this was? But then again, even with other religious orders, they seem to have lost their... their charism too. Thank you.
Thanks, Ed.
It's a question we're eternally debating, and that now in Quebec we're trying to look ahead. For the last 20-30 years, we've been just trying to see what happened, what's going on. We can come to a partial answer, and I think one answer would have to be the whole question of formation. I think anybody who's been in Montreal, is struck by the number of churches that there are around and the number of, the quantity of, if you like, Catholic paraphernalia, that is around there. You have beautiful statues everywhere, and you think, well, these people must be really Catholic. But then you go, half the churches are closed now, and there's very few people. And it points to, I may be wrong, but it points to a kind of veneer coating type of Catholicism where the exterior was given a lot of importance, but somehow why exactly is to me remains a bit of a mystery, but the depth wasn't always touched upon. However, there are a number of saints after all in Quebec, right? There are saints, and I'm convinced there are more to come. I think we're looking now in the future in Quebec, we're trying to look back. Not so much look back all the time and say, because, like, I, you know, nobody goes like this in Quebec. No priest, they, the priests go, very few now. But the young ones, they do, you know. Yeah. They start wearing their clergymen, and because they don't do that, because a lot of the older ones, because they don't want to identify themselves with that period where everybody was dressed as a, in fact, in the past, it was in the 50s, it was all, right. Everybody was dressed in a cassock, you know? Everybody, you know, all the priests.
Right.
And now it's the opposite, now they've yeah. gone over to the other side. But I think we're looking to the future, and what's happened in Quebec now is that the schools can no longer teach religion. The church, the schools are no longer Catholic or Protestant, they're now English or French, right? And religion has been now left to the parishes, right? And I think this will be, this is actually a hopeful sign. We have a new cardinal in Quebec, Cardinal Ouellette, who's the cardinal of Quebec City. He was named a few months ago. And, you know, he's making it, he's giving a huge priority to this whole area of formation, especially of the young people. And they've connected very well with him with regards to, you know, World Youth Day. He's connected very well with them. And just as a lot of people from a certain age bracket know a lot about Catholicism and the externals of Catholicism, they know how to say the sign of the cross and so forth, yet they don't actually practice, the younger people, you know, don't know much, but they're open, mm. you know, they're open.
Father, tell the Christian Brothers story.
Christian Brothers story. Well, as a result of that, of this idea of all the formation having to be in the parishes, the Christian Brothers in a town called Chambly in the diocese of Saint-Jean-Longueuil, which is on the south shore of Montreal, because Montreal is an island, right? Yeah. Montreal is an island, and on the south shore, that's where I actually grew up, on the south shore. There's a place called Chambly, and the Christian Brothers there, well, they had a church there, and they said, well, let's see, you know, we've got to get some catechism. Let's see. Okay, well, the thing is, catechism, we imagine, for kids, you know, First Communion and then confirmation. But they started registering kids and their parents, all right? So parents and children started registering. I mean, parents also, so that they could receive instruction. And before they knew it, they had hundreds and hundreds of people registered for these catechism classes, such that they didn't have room in the parish. They had to rent a big building, and you know, it's become very, very popular. No? Yeah. So you know, these kind of initiatives, you know, show the sort of thirst that there is, you know, yeah. for not just the externals, but well, what is really behind the deep externals. You know?
So the message there is don't wallow in the frustrations yeah. or maybe bemoan, but look at the opportunities. And the yeah. hunger and thirst that's there, and look for opportunities. And again, when I think of the call of Opus Dei to encourage the person to seek holiness where they yeah. are, that isn't a call to be self-focused,
no.
right? It's a call to be light and salt yeah. in the world, right?
Yeah. Oh yeah, to be an example, and you know, the whole idea of you know, acquiring prestige in your work, doing your work very well, so that you're an example, so that people see, you know, this guy, this woman knows how to work, and therefore you have a certain amount of pull, and you can actually, you know, have your words also have weight, because humanly speaking, you work well.
Yeah. Yeah.
And but it's through friendship. It's like what Dwight did with me. You know, it's through friendship. It's not saying, read this. You know, it's you know, personal friendship, apostle friendship of confidence. Yeah.
I wonder if you can maybe close the program with some words of encouragement to the people, if they've maybe know people like you were mm-hmm. in their life, or maybe sons and daughters that left the church. Any words of encouragement to them that they might do to help nurture
well,
the return of these friends?
I mean, this is not necessarily what you have to do, but I'll right. just tell you what happened to me once. I'll just give you an anecdote, and then I'll tell you what I suggest. The other day, every Tuesday and Wednesday, I hear confessions at the cathedral, which looks exactly like St. Peter's. It's a copy of St. Peter's, the cathedral in Montreal. And every day I go there, I mean, I'm going like this. I'm just like, it's like, you know, lots of confessions, you know. So I was coming back one day, walking along the street, dressed as a clergyman, and I heard this guy behind me say, hey, you, you. And I, And I turn around and I said, it can't be me. And I keep walking, and then, hey, you, father. So well, that must be me. So I turn around, and this guy has a $20 bill, and he's looking at me in the eye. And he says, take this. And I say, who is this guy? I don't know this guy. And he says, take this. This is for you. This is because you're wearing your clergyman. You know? He says, every time I see any priest with a clergyman, I give them $20. So I said, okay. He says, the same thing with nuns. When I see nuns, I give them. So I said, well, okay, I'll give it to the church, but you know, you should pray for us. And he says, no. You pray, I pay. You pray, I pay. You know? So these encouraging signs sometimes happen that people are, you know, they want the faith again.
They want the model. They want.
And I would encourage people to remember that, you know, intellectual conviction is not necessarily everything. You know, some people come to the faith after reading books and books and books, and you know, like Edith Stein, you know, she read the Life of Saint Teresa, and you know, and are real intellectuals. I mean, I did a doctorate, okay, but I don't consider myself really essentially an intellectual. I would encourage people to remember that the adolescence, end of adolescence, is a time when people make, you know, very important decisions that are going to affect them the rest of their life. You know, how did I know that my decision was going to affect me so much? You know, but what did I know? I didn't know anything. I mean, I didn't have all the wherewithal to be able to make that decision. But there was some, I think, you know, some desire, like no thought of the dangers that this might pose, and you know, I just let's go for it. You know, blaze a trail, as I remember reading in the Way. You know, and so, yeah. If one encourages young people, especially teenagers, to generosity, mm-hmm. and treats them kind of like adults, mm-hmm. and encourages their friendships, you know, this can go a long way. They don't have to know everything, but they will bit by bit, yeah. discover
there's
a lot.
And there comes that balance, as you said. On the one hand, our lives as workers, as husbands and fathers, need to be models for them of Jesus. Mm-hmm. But then there's also the balance, and we need to talk to them about Jesus too. I mean, there's the both and. We mm-hmm. sometimes the models can be good, but if the data doesn't come along, then we may end up with a hollow faith that imitates but doesn't know.
Yeah.
On the other hand, we can have the other extreme where we get lots of information, but we don't have the models on how to live it or good models, mm-hmm. and so then it falls down because of hypocrisy. So that need for both and, which is so important. Father, would you give us a blessing as we close the program?
Be my pleasure. Through the intercession of the Blessed Virgin Mary, may the Lord bless you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and may His power come down among you.
Thank you very much. Thank you for joining us.
My pleasure.
Home, and I encourage any Canadian listeners to pass the word, because our attempt is to always have on this third Monday of the month a Canadian visitor. And Father, you're helping us find more converts in Canada.
Try to find
some more. For that. Father's example of his friend Dwight and the influence that Dwight had on Father's openness reminds me of that story in the beginning of the Gospel of John, where we see the brothers, Jesus going to a friend, Philip, who invites a friend to Jesus, or going to Andrew, who then brings his brother Peter. And so we see Jesus using relationships to bring others to him. And it emphasizes that power and that importance of our relationships through whom Jesus can speak. Sometimes it is through the word of the scriptures directly, but sometimes it's through art and through music and through culture. But I do believe that one of the most powerful tools that our Lord uses to reach us is our friends and family. And so we need not to be afraid to bring our friends and family to Jesus, to talk to them about Jesus, but also never forget to keep lifting them in prayer so that grace can work in their hearts to bring that openness to how God is trying to touch them in their lives. I pray this has been a good program for you tonight. And you know, I look forward to seeing you every week on The Journey Home. And I'll see you again next week. God bless you.